Now we need to discuss the possibility of how you keep all this stuff in one place. It's called compartmentalization. Once these early replicators had developed a toolkit to enhance self-replication, they needed some place to put it. They needed a toolbox. So where would be a likely shelter from the storm of all the waves of oceans and everything going on? One possibility is that you might have had these early replicators out in the soup, but they found shelter between sheets of mica. So these complex molecules, if they'd gotten into a safe haven like this, they would have been able to manufacture their ribozymes and maintain access to it so that they could take advantage of it to replicate themselves over and over again. And mica is viewed as a likely first haven for early life because mica sheets have high levels of potassium, quite similar to the composition of cell walls in living organisms.
The following animation is meant as an analogy to explain the need for compartmentalization in the RNA world. Here, the RNA replicase is represented by a blue cube. If the replicase encounters another replicase, it can make a copy, resulting in two identical replicases. Our replicase, however, is not so picky. If it encounters an RNA that isn't a replicase, it will copy that too. In an environment where there are many different RNAs, the replicase will quickly become outnumbered. What's the solution? By placing the replicases in a compartment, such as a vesicle, the replicases are separated from the other RNAs and will only make copies of each other.
Although the sheets of mica may have provided the necessary compartmentalization in certain areas where those geological features were present, more widely, we might want to look for some other model as a potential toolbox in which we can keep all these bits and pieces safely together to work together. So now we want to see how the first cell walls might have arisen, and these could have actually originated spontaneously in the same way that the self-replicating RNA could have replicated. And these videos now are going to take you through a sequence where we see how cell walls could have been originally generated by geological processes where fatty acids come together to form kind of a hollow ball that the RNA can reside inside. So I'm going to show you now a sequence of these videos.
Hydrothermal vents, from deep-sea black smokers to land-bound geysers, may have been sites where prebiotically important molecules on early Earth were formed. This animation shows the formation of fatty acids deep in the Earth below a geyser. Mineral surfaces can catalyze the stepwise formation of hydrocarbon chains from carbon monoxide and hydrogen. Here, hydrogen atoms are shown as white spheres. Carbon is gray and oxygen in red. The reaction results in the growth of hydrocarbon chains of various lengths that are eventually released from the mineral face as fatty acids and related compounds. Because the fatty acids are at low concentrations in the water, they are unable to form higher order structures such as micelles and membranes. Following the violent explosion of the geyser, some water is released into the atmosphere as tiny, microscopic droplets. Fatty acids synthesized along the mineral walls of the geyser are found in low concentration in these droplets, with the longer fatty acids at the air-water interface. A gust of wind evaporates the water molecules in the water droplet, causing the fatty acid to form lightweight airborne particulates that can be transported across the landscape, perhaps eventually settling out and accumulating in localized areas. Under the proper conditions of concentration and pH, fatty acid micelles may join together to form a vesicle. Individual micelles first join to create a large, sheet-like bilayer. Random fluctuations of the fatty acid bilayer lead to the formation of a cup-like shape. When in close proximity, the ends of the sheet can seal together, forming a spherical vesicle. Vesicles formed from fatty acids are extremely stable and are able to maintain the same shape and size over the course of days or even months. Individual fatty acids within the vesicle, however, are very dynamic. Fatty acid molecules are constantly entering and leaving the vesicle membrane, and flipping between the inner and outer leaflets. In this animation, the flipping fatty acids are highlighted in white. Recent research has shown that single nucleotides of RNA are able to traverse fatty acid vesicle membranes. This animation shows one mechanism by which nucleotides may enter the vesicle. Nucleotides bump into and interact with fatty acid head groups, colored in red, in the outer leaflet. Some of the fatty acids interacting with the nucleotide flip to the inner leaflet, carrying the nucleotide along and releasing it on the inside of the vesicle.
So we've had, by physical processes, the manufacture of what's essentially going to be like a cell wall, but it's a permeable cell wall that allows nucleotides to come in. Interestingly, though, once they're inside, if they can get together in a chain, or if there'd been a pre-existing chain inside, the RNA strand cannot leave. So this is only permeable to the smaller molecules. Now we want to see what happens as we have continued growth of these micelles by a vesicle.
When fatty acid micelles are added to a solution containing preformed vesicles, the vesicles are observed to grow rapidly. This is thought to happen through the formation of a micelle shell around the vesicle. Individual fatty acid molecules are then transferred from the micelle to the outer leaflet of the vesicle, resulting in vesicle growth and micelle shrinkage. Fatty acids must flip-flop between the inner and outer leaflet of the vesicle to ensure even growth of the vesicle membrane. This animation shows the process of protocell growth and division. RNA nucleotides shown as blue dots traverse the protocell membrane and are used by an RNA replicase to make a copy of another RNA replicase. Meanwhile, the protocell membrane is constantly growing through the addition of micelles. Increasing the surface area faster than the volume causes the protocell shape to become elongated and unstable. The protocell eventually splits into daughter protocells, with the contents of the original protocell randomly divided between the daughters.
So, without any programming from the RNA itself, the physical structure of the vesicle is capable of growing in the right environment to where several of these vesicles can emerge from a single ancestor. So it behaves a lot like a modern bacteria would do in terms of cell division. So if we have this protocell with the RNA and ribozymes inside, it's a necessary toolkit so that this RNA can replicate itself very, very efficiently. We have a permeable membrane through which more nucleotides can come inside from the environment so that more RNA can be manufactured. Once it's in there, it can't leave. But the very forces of manufacturing the RNA inside actually can further stimulate the cell growth. And it could also then happen that the mechanisms inside the cell would be such as to favor those RNA variants who promote the growth of the vesicle at the expense of neighboring cells. So we'd have competition for this limiting resource of the micelles, and we have now what's recognizable very much like modern life.